Bonjour tout le monde. I want to begin by recognizing that a lot of people have now been stuck at home for a week or more because of COVID-19. If that's starting to take a toll, it's understandable. But we can't afford to stop now. I want to be clear. Social distancing, physical distancing, is the single best way to keep the people around you safe. What does that mean? It means keeping 2 meters between yourself and someone else. It means avoiding groups. It means staying home as much as possible. If you choose to ignore that advice, if you choose to get together with people or go to crowded places, you're not just putting yourself at risk, you're putting others at risk too. Your elderly relative who's in a senior's home, or your friend with a pre-existing condition. Our nurses and doctors on the front lines. Our workers stocking shelves at a grocery store. They need you to make the right choices. They need you to do your part. We've all seen the pictures online of people who seem to think they're invincible. Well, you're not. Enough is enough. Go home and stay home. This is what we all need to be doing. And we're going to make sure this happens, whether by educating people more on the risks or by enforcing the rules, if that's needed. Nothing that could help is off the table. Today, we're launching federal advertising campaigns. You'll see faces that you know and trust, people from our cultural sector, getting out the recommendations from our healthcare workers. Not having heard this message won't be an excuse. We're reaching everyone. Listening is your duty, and staying home is your way to serve. Every day, there are more and more people who step up and heed this call. Just yesterday, Team Canada and the Canadian Paralympic team made the tough decision not to send athletes to the Olympic and Paralympic Games this summer. I know this is heartbreaking for so many people. Athletes, coaches, staff, and fans. But this was absolutely the right call, and everyone should follow their lead. No matter who you are, if you're doing your part, I want to say thank you. You are saving lives. And when it gets hard, know that your government is right there with you. On Wednesday, we unveiled an $82 billion plan for people and businesses affected by the virus. If you're worried about making ends meet, we're putting more money in your pocket. If you own a small business, we're helping you bridge to better times. Tomorrow, the House of Commons will reconvene to pass emergency legislation and put this plan in motion. For farmers and people across the agri-food business, I know these are hard times too. So we're also opening up $5 billion in additional lending capacity. Starting today, farmers and producers can apply through Farm Credit Canada for the support they need to keep food growing and get it onto our tables. On that note, I want to say thank you to people right across the entire food sector. Day in and day out, you grow, transport, and stock the food that feed our families. Last week, we also announced a plan to mobilize industry so our hospitals have the medical support and equipment they need. Later today, I will have a call with the First Ministers to discuss our continued coordination on quarantine and self-isolation. We're working together to ensure that everyone has what they need, whether that's equipment for testing or medical supplies. This evening, the Premiers and I will also talk about continuing to move forward with measures to support families and small businesses to ensure our economy rebounds. For Canadians stranded abroad, we're working with airlines to get people home. People should be returning by commercial means while they're still available. Air Canada, WestJet, Air Transat and Sunwing all have flights this week. As of today, we've secured authorizations for Air Canada to operate 3 flights for this week for Canadians in Peru, and there will be 2 more flights in the coming days from Morocco. We've also helped secure an Air Canada flight from Spain, as well as Air Transat flights, including two from Honduras and one each from Ecuador, El Salvador, and Guatemala. If you're a Canadian abroad, register with the government now so we can send you updates and contact you. You need to do this if you haven't done it already. Depuis le début de cette crise, on utilise tous les outils à notre disposition pour gérer la situation. On est chanceux, les innovateurs canadiens sont parmi les meilleurs au monde et ils veulent faire partie de la solution. On a investi 275 millions de dollars dans la recherche sur la COVID-19 et le développement des vaccins. La vaccination et les traitements antiviraux sont des options qu'on doit absolument poursuivre. On le voit avec la grippe. Les vaccins empêchent les gens d'être malades, protègent les plus vulnérables et font en sorte que de moins en moins de monde se rende à l'urgence. Aujourd'hui, j'annonce qu'on va investir 192 millions de dollars pour soutenir directement la création et la production de vaccins au Canada. On finance une solution à long terme contre la COVID-19 chez nous. On va signer une entente avec l'entreprise Abcellera de Vancouver pour soutenir leur travail visant à traiter et à prévenir la COVID-19. On travaille aussi avec l'entreprise Medicago de Québec pour produire et tester des vaccins. En même temps, on alloue également des fonds au Vaccine and Infectious Disease Organization de l'Université de la Saskatchewan pour le développement de vaccins et les essais cliniques. Le Canada a besoin de la capacité nécessaire pour produire des traitements en masse le plus rapidement possible. On investit donc aussi dans les installations du Conseil national de recherche de Canada à Montréal. Today, I can announce that we are providing $192 million to directly support vaccine development and production in Canada. We're investing in a long-term solution to COVID-19 right here at home. Our government will be signing an agreement with Vancouver-based Abcellera to support their work on drugs to prevent and treat COVID-19. We're also working with Quebec City-based Medicago for vaccine testing and production. At the same time, we're providing funding for the University of Saskatchewan's Vaccine and Infectious Disease Organization for development and clinical trials. Once there are promising options, Canada needs the capacity to mass-produce treatments as quickly as possible. That's why we're investing in the National Research Council of Canada's facility in Montreal to prepare for the rollout. These are critical steps forward, but we have to remember that vaccines won't be ready overnight. They will take months to develop and test. So while that's happening, we need to work to mitigate the impacts of this virus. And luckily, we have the tools we need right here at home. Blue Dot in Toronto was among the first in the world to identify the spread of COVID-19 coming in 9 days ahead of the World Health Organization's public warning. We've signed a contract to use this Canadian software to model the disease. It will help us track and therefore slow the spread. Minister Baines has also sent a call to action to every university, college, polytechnic, and CEGEP in the country. Their labs have the resources and expertise to be part of this fight. We've asked them to identify equipment they've got, like masks and ventilators. At the same time, we're looking at innovative solutions they can be part of, including 3D printing of medical supplies. Many institutions have already stepped up, and many more will do the same. If you need more information, please go to buyandsell.gc.ca. We need all hands on deck. Nous demandons à chaque université, collège, école polytechnique et cégep du pays de nous donner tous les masques et ventilateurs qu'ils ont ou de nous proposer d'autres façons d'aider, par exemple avec une imprimante 3D. Beaucoup d'établissements ont déjà répondu à l'appel et beaucoup d'autres pensent à le faire. Pour plus de renseignements, consultez le site achatetvente.gc.ca. On a tous un rôle à jouer dans la lutte contre la COVID-19. Même si vous n'êtes pas un ambulancier ou un chercheur, vous pouvez sauver des vies. en restant à la maison le plus possible, en maintenant une distance d'au moins 2 mètres avec les autres si vous devez sortir, vous pouvez faire toute la différence. C'est comme ça qu'on peut se protéger et protéger nos infirmières, nos médecins et nos professionnels de la santé qui prennent soin de ceux qui en ont besoin. Il faut suivre les recommandations de nos agences de santé publique, il faut leur faire confiance et il faut les écouter. Hier, j'ai eu un moment où j'ai parlé aux enfants directement. Aujourd'hui, j'ai une pensée pour nos aînés. On a tous des êtres chers qui sont chez eux, qui sont très vulnérables. Alors, appelez-leur et dites-leur que vous les aimez. Je pense moi-même à mon beau-père, le papa de Sophie, Jean, qui suit des traitements pour le cancer depuis quelques mois. Alors, on ne le voyait pas souvent, mais aujourd'hui, c'est sa fête. Joyeux anniversaire, Jean-Jean. Il a 77 ans aujourd'hui. Pensons à nos aînés, pensons à nos êtres chers et faisons tout ce qu'on peut pour les garder en sécurité. C'est comme ça qu'on va freiner la COVID-19. Merci de faire votre part et sachez que notre gouvernement va continuer de travailler jour et nuit pour vous appuyer. Ensemble, on va s'en sortir. Merci.